So today we are playing Freedom Fighters.
Awesome.
Which is a game by IO Interactive, who are most famous for the Hitman games.
Right.
Slightly, I guess, less famous for the Kane and Lynch games. One of the few games that they have developed that was published by EA. On its very surface, this game is a third-person shooter. But the really key thing about it is that it has a pretty strong squad and squad strategy mechanic.
So it's a single-player game. Is it?
It is. I mean, there's a multiplayer component, but right. It's only on LAN play. It's not on Xbox Live or anything like that.
Okay. Yeah, but as the player, you sort of order your fellow freedom fighters around.
Correct. And so you play as this character named Christopher Stone. And we are... It's a good...
That's a pretty generic hero name.
Generic hero name. Yeah. And we are in Soviet-occupied New York.
Right. Little alternate history going on.
Yeah, the gist of this game is it's not really set in any particular time period. I mean, it's pretty much just a contemporary game, or at least contemporary for when this game was released, which I think was 1984 or 2005.
Let me check. I think it's 2003.
Was it that old?
2003 actually.
Okay, so we are going into much older games we have thus far on. Now the third episode of the B-List. So you start out with every mission, you're just by yourself. And you see underneath my life bar there, I've got these three circles, and like two of them are filled with like representing a downward pointing arrow.
Yes.
So basically that represents my charisma level, which each one of those circles represents a dude I can command.
Okay.
And so I'm pretty early on in the game. I started out, I played the game a little bit this weekend just to brush up on it, and also start getting into the game mechanics, because at the very beginning, you have no charisma.
okay, just
such
like...
Such as life.
Yes, exactly.
So here, this is how, a big part of the game plays out, is I'm just going to order my dudes to go attack all those guys, and I'm going to sit up here with a machine gun and give them support.
All right. So, the downward pointing arrows have changed to sort of lightning bolts.
Yeah, the default is, hey, circle up on me and just kind of follow me around as my own private murder squad.
Yeah.
They're not doing a good job of covering my flank. And the downward pointing arrow is basically just follow me around and give me support. You can also order them to attack. You're going to go tell them, go get that guy.
So we're streaming this both on GameSpot.com and on Twitch.tv/GameSpot. there goes...
So I just got hit with the Frogger moment of I just got run over by a car, which of course is an instant death, and it came up from out of nowhere, so I forgot to look where I was going and got run over by a car.
If you're watching on Twitch or GameSpot, you can leave a comment / chime in the chat, and we'll be keeping an eye on that. If you do have any questions or anything for Tyler or myself, feel free to chime in. Come on, try this. Sid says, hey, Kara and Tyler, can Justin in the chat? I don't quite know what you mean. Do you mean...
I believe Justin can in the chat.
Justin can and occasionally does totally in the chat.
But he can only in the chat.
Yes.
Also, can connected to internet, which is a message from... A favorite message of mine from a hotel in Japan, that when you use their free Wi-Fi and register through their Wi-Fi registration page, it says, can connected to internet. I will do my best to not get run over by, Frogger murdered by a car.
Can you ever commandeer vehicles in this game?
No, vehicles are not drivable in this game.
Okay. but they're blow-up-able.
They certainly are. They do function nicely as exploding red exploding barrels.
Yes.
So anyways, the three basic attacks, your commands that you can issue to your squad are so you can just have them, you know, circle up on you and follow you around. You can have them defend a particular area, and you can also tell them to go attack a particular enemy.
Okay.
And you can issue your commands either to individual soldiers or
to the whole gang.
Yeah, or just tell the whole crew, you know, hey, go do this thing. Eventually, you can lead a squad of like 12 people. That's where you end up at the towards the end of the game.
Okay.
To where you pretty much almost don't ever need to do any fighting yourself. But we're still pretty early on, so we're still doing a lot of the fighting ourselves.
Yeah.
And it doesn't feel like a lot of third-person games as you see them now. I mean, especially because the whole dual-stick shooter control was something that still most developers are still kind of developing the language for.
Definitely.
So this game has a bunch of weirdly mapped controls by modern standards.
Okay.
Like, you know, I have my zoom aiming there, but that's, and I do that by getting into that with the clicking in on the left stick while aiming with the right.
Bring it on.
Tell my guys to go fight. But also, you know, when I'm not in that zoomed in view, the firing is controlled by some very loose auto aim, where I just kind of point myself in the general direction of an enemy and pull the trigger, and
right,
a flurry of not very well aimed bullets goes in their direction, but it mostly gets the job done.
Can you see him?
The other thing that's key to this game is that so in each, as they refer to them, chapter in the game.
Move
it. You heard me.
There's various territories that you have to basically take over.
So do you have a certain amount of freedom, as it were, to kind of go about the map as you see? Are they kind of open world maps?
They're reasonably open. Uh-huh. But where I was getting at with the different regions,
yes, sir.
Getting murdered by a machine gun there. So each map has its own like primary and secondary objective. The primary objective is always pretty much just raise the American flag over a key building. each terrain has like its own setback thing of like, you know, in the first chapter of the game, you know, you're supposed to reclaim a police station. But the police are pinned down by a bunch of snipers, so you have to go to a different neighborhood and get some C4. Then you can plant it at the gas station, which is where the snipers are perched.
I see.
So you do this kind of back and forth between the various territories you have available to you in each chapter. You know, completely different secondary objectives and then primary objectives until ultimately you complete everything in that. All the objectives in those territories, and then you move on to the next chapter. And the chapter breaks are kind of cool too, because you get like the main character Chris adopts a different look, because like you start out of the game and it's actually kind of a Mario Brothers joke in that, you know, you play this dude who is a plumber, and I'm being shot at by unknown directions. And in fact, I remember the developers once talking about how the game is intended to be, at least the character's supposed to be a little bit of a parody of the ridiculousness of Mario as a hero.
So, Freedom Fighters, you know, at the time that it was released, I don't really know what kind of reception it got across the board, but in case anyone's wondering, here on GameSpot.com, it received a glowing 9.3, and was reviewed by Jeff Gerstmann, who said, "Anyone looking for thrilling action with refined control and a great premise need look no further than Freedom Fighters." So he was obviously a fan and admirer of the game at the time.
and I was a fan of I was at least a fan of the game, hearing about it as it was being developed, and I remember, you know, that actually being fairly early on in my career here, but
sure.
But hearing about, you know, hearing that score was like the final words, like, okay, this game is definitely worth checking out.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah, but the weird legacy of this game is, and you know, why I added the caveat of, you know, like, instead of just looking at games that are flawed, because this game isn't really. You know, mechanically this game is pretty sound. I mean, it feels a little clunky by today's standards.
Sure, sure.
Yeah, the biggest problem with this game is very few people I know actually played it.
Yeah, yeah, that is, in retrospect, seems, you know, odd that this game was not a bigger, maybe mainstream hit than it was.
So what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to take out a bridge that the Russians are using for their supply chain into New York here. And I think, yep, I can just go and place the C4 here, and now my secondary objective in this area is complete. And now that should make certain combats in the... and the other terrains a little bit easier. I'm a cool guy, so I don't look at explosions.
Yeah, yeah.
Other thing of note, although it seemed maybe a little bit less so at the time, music by Jesper Kidd.
Jesper Kidd, that's right, yeah.
And I believe that was also when Jesper Kidd was still like the in-house musician at IO Interactive.
I think you're probably right. Oh,
yeah.
Wow,
yeah,
nice kind of Soviet, a little bit of like the Hunt for Red October thing going on.
Yeah, it's definitely playing on its tropes as a, you know, Russian occupation of America theme. Although it never really, I mean, it sticks mostly to the Russian themes. There's no real, which is weird, like when you strike a decisive blow for the American resistance forces that, you know, you never hear any kind of, like Star Spangled Banner or anything
right.
like that. It's you actually hear these Russian themes whenever that happens. But that's fine. And so now I'm. Let's see. Looks like I can get up here. And here's another bunch of Freedom Fighters,
all
which
right.
is fine. But actually, I'm going
to. You're kind of maxed out.
I am maxed out, but also I'm also at the point where I don't know if I'm at the best place to attack the main objective in this area. I can at least do an autosave here real quick.
Sure.
Or not an autosave. This game doesn't really do autosaving very much. Because it's easy to get to a point where, like, you've been playing in a mission for a while and you've got to feel like a good feeling momentum going, and then you get shot by one stray bullet, and then you've been set back a good 15 or 20 minutes. I hope that doesn't happen here, because that would be frustrating. Hello, dudes. So, yeah, you just see these groups of other freedom fighters that, you know, are there to look tough, but they are not actually here to help you unless you have the charisma to sway them to your side.
Can your existing guys get killed or only like wounded and then you can revive them?
Just wounded and revived, and there's no like persistence between them. They're actually it's not like you have named dudes like you would in like an XCOM game.
Right, they don't like,
that.
Level up and become more skillful as you.
Yeah, so they do tend to be pretty disposable.
Sure.
But get some cover from that machine gun before it does me real wrong. We got any kind of questions from the chat?
Not at the moment. I mean, Kong Plus says, it's funny some people call this underrated. I feel a lot of people I know played it and loved it. So definitely,
Yeah, again, I wouldn't consider this game very much underrated. The only reason why I'm playing it is because, well, I think it's a great game, and also because it's just a game that I feel like a lot of people just overlooked.
Right. Yeah. Worth revisiting. Or in my case, visiting.
The good news is that it plays just fine on a Xbox 360. That's how we're playing it today.
Sure.
I was hoping that there would be a PC version that was easily accessible. I think there is a PC version, but...
It definitely was released on PC.
I just don't know if... I just don't think it's, like, on Steam or anything like
right,
that.
Right, yeah.
Oh, dear.
Oh, no.
Get picked off by the sniper up there while, or by the machine gun while focusing on the sniper. But at least... I should be able to get back to, not too far away from where I just was. So now I think all of my secondary objectives in this chapter are complete, so now I can hopefully just, if there's not too much dying, I can just kind of sweep through and... Well, let's see. That game did not recognize that I took out that bridge. That's frustrating. That's what that is.
Take it easy.
Okay.
Thank you so much. All right.
I was not expecting that, but we'll persist.
Wow.
That guy should be trained in the use of firearms around explosive barrels. Maybe that was the game saying, hey, I know we just threw you for a frustrating turn, but we're going to throw you a bone here.
Yeah.
Yeah, and this game has some other controls that seem really weird now, like instead of getting into my quick aiming by pulling in the left trigger, instead the left trigger is my jump/climb button.
Oh yeah, that would be, a difficult adjustment to go back to.
I think I've gotten myself used to this game again enough that I'm not constantly jumping whenever I get into a firefight, which makes for a hilarious visual.
Yeah.
But now that I at least have a small crew of guys, it is not so bad to, I'm not... Because early on in the game, you're using that aimed view a lot because ammunition is scarce and because you don't have any backup guys helping you out.
So you need to be you need to tread very carefully.
Yeah. Definitely using cover a lot more.
Sid Burn 19 has a pro tip for you, Tyler. Just, he says... kill the enemies before they kill you.
Working on that, yeah. But thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
That's like one of those tips that you work on for the entirety of your gaming lifestyle.
Exactly.
And so that, one of the most significant things to have at any given time in this game is medikits, or as this game refers to them, medic kits.
Oh, yes.
Not only because they allow you to replenish your own health, they are what allow you to revive your guys when they have fallen in battle. So, basically they're just kind of in a down state. You don't even have a timeout on them before they die permanently or anything like that. So it's pretty forgiving in that regard.
Sure.
And also, you can encounter... if you find yourself even with spares, that man has a sniping rifle. I will take it.
That sniper rifleman with his sniper rifle.
But also you can encounter like injured soldiers and that aren't part of your crew, and you can revive them and they won't immediately become part of your crew, but you get a bonus to your charisma, which is the stat that determines how many people you can have.
Right.
Yeah, basically it works like experience. You get, for every 100 charisma points, you can have another guy in your squad. Oh no, I am out of gun bullets.
Digital Renegade said... Oh, he's talking... Digital Renegade talking about Operation Flashpoint by Codemasters. Okay, saying I'd love to see a live stream of the original Operation Flashpoint. That game is awesome, dated graphics, but still a fantastic game. I still play it.
I think that would be a doable and welcome addition to the the themes of this live show.
Yes.
All right. Stop shooting at my dude. I'm going to shoot you in the butt.
Six bullets to the butt, and that guy goes down.
And... still a guy back there.
Find the red.
Yeah, go get that guy.
Better dead than red.
This'll fix you up.
Sidburn19 asking, does this game have a cover system?
No. It is a game that would probably benefit heavily from a cover system, it does not have.
You're hurting there, Tyler.
Oh, it's a sneaky sniper up there.
Yeah.
We'll just deal with him.
There you go.
Get a little bit of health going there, and then check my map and relearn where I gotta go. That's right, I've gotta go.
Get back here! Go, go, go!
Okay, so it did remember that blew up that bridge.
Yeah.
Okay. It just forgot to tell me.
Yo, man, blowing up that bridge will stop the Reds from stepping out into the other neighborhoods. But remember, you need some serious TNT if you're going to do it right.
Well, hopefully I did it right. So that's that. This character who's just referred to as the kid.
Oh, he shows up in
who he
various...
just, you know, kind of gives you advice.
Okay.
About, you know, like how to proceed into your next area.
Yeah.
But no, there's no Digital Renegade. Yes, there is. There is a crouch, but that's about as good as you get as far as cover. This game came out before even relatively unpopular games like Killswitch that first introduced the idea of cover into third-person shooter games.
So this is Freedom Fighters HQ, I presume, yes?
Yes, this is the Rebel base, mm-hmm. Which is just kind of in this sewer... I don't know, it looks like kind of like a sewer spillway kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, you access it through the manholes.
Yeah, but yeah, basically the sewer system manholes basically just ended up being like your doorways to back to this kind of hub area.
Yeah.
Here. There's this nice little serene tree garden thing. But ostensibly, you know, the Russians have not figured out where the rebels are hiding now, so we can use the sewers to get to various areas. Let's go to the hotel.
Take control of the old hotel. The Soviets have established...
where I have already liberated a prison camp.
Oh.
And now we'll try and claim the hotel, which I believe is being used as a Russian stronghold.
How dare they.
Those wacky Russians.
Those zany Russians. Hey, there's the kid.
There's a good old kid again.
Thank you, it's already
here,
getting...
Take this.
Oh. And I believe those are some... wounded Russian soldiers that I can heal them and then their loyalties are now mine.
Oh.
Because... I guess the Red Army doesn't keep look after their troops very well.
Right.
Me out, guys. Especially because right now I have no bullets.
Oh, I see.
Regroup. Come on.
Nice big environments in this game.
Yeah, they don't look the best, but
you know. Damn it. Oh.
may be a thing. Oh, there may be a bounding box around that car that is slightly bigger than the car.
That's what I was thinking, yeah. Or maybe the... Oh, there... Wait. Did you get him? Once?
Oh, and I am out of bullets. All right. And now I have a sniping rifle.
That should get the job done.
But I can aim carefully.
You'll be fine.
That's encouraging. Walk it off. Just come on.
I know you were previously dead in a ditch, but get over it. We've got a war to fight. That man should pay better attention and have better situational awareness. I've forgotten how useful a sniper rifle is in this game.
Oh.
Yelling to myself because all my troops are injured right now. Oh dear.
So Shaky Bakery asking, what year did this game come out? 2003.
Yep, that's why this game is not looking the freshest of the bunch.
She's got it where it counts.
Oh no.
Oh no! Sid Byrne asks, do you find it hard to go back and replay old school games since games have evolved so much over the last few years? You know, for instance, regenerating health.
Yes.
It's hard to get back, you know, because control schemes are so standardized today. You know, you kind of play one first person shooter, you've essentially played them all in terms of being able to just pick up the controller and jump in. You might have to like, oh, okay, in this button, in this game, grenades is like right bumper or whatever, but you know, for the most part they're very similar. But you know, when you go back to games like this that predate that standardization, it's definitely an adjustment.
Absolutely. And more than that, I think it's also a matter of you can say what you want about games have largely become easier, and I think that's really true. But they've also just become a lot more refined. And, you know, sometimes games would just be hard just because they're, you know, they didn't control very well. You know, getting back into what you're saying of, like, being able to... It's like, okay, I know how the mechanics of shooting a gun tends to work in video games. I don't need a lengthy tutorial explaining how to get the job done with regards to that. You know, obviously you need that stuff in there in modern games because, well, you never know. Maybe people haven't played a shooter before.
Yeah.
But most people have, and most shooters play pretty much the same.
Yes.
And that's part of the refinement of it, but just, you know, making... Just kind of smoothing over rough edges and not making it feel like you're reinventing the wheel every time you're stepping into a game definitely helps. And of course, you know, other, you know, implementing things like cover that, you know, I think would be a good fit for a game like this.
Yeah.
And definitely would make the gameplay feel a bit more natural rather than kind of trying to use cover by just, you know, nudging around that bounding box.
Yeah, stand near this dumpster sort of thing.
Yeah, which, I mean, you kind of end up doing that sort of thing a lot in this game.
Right.
You would be if you're, well, doing better at it than I am. Here, I'm sneaking into this. I am stealing Russian supplies. Oh, and sneaking behind their enemy lines.
SidBurn19 says, trying to keep you busy with questions, Caro. Thanks, Sid. Appreciate it. We don't want dead air here. So, you know, keep the questions coming. We're relying on you, yeah. Viewers. We got nothing. Call Me Joe 2 points out, or recalls, system requirements for this game is a Pentium 3.733 megahertz. 128 megabytes of RAM, 32 megabytes of RAM, 650 megabytes hard disk.
I feel like there's a story behind the very specific knowledge being shared with regard to this game's system requirements, such as did this person have to do a significant for him at the time system upgrade in order to play this game? Kind of sounds like it.
So this game also, so it came out on all the on PlayStation 2, Xbox, and even GameCube.
That was the one I couldn't remember, is if it did come out on GameCube. But that was when all those systems had such parity that, like, it was pretty much a given that it would come out on all three platforms. And also when, it was an EA game, so it was going to be pretty likely that
right.
it just comes out for everything.
Is that a little ragdoll effects going on there?
Yeah, a little bit of ragdoll.
Yeah, a little bit of like
proto, what was the BMX game? Not Matt Hoffman, although that was another BMX game.
Yeah. BMX Triple X.
Oh, let's not remember that game. We're gonna hoist the American flag.
Oh, nice.
So there you get this little stat screen of like
tear in my American eyes.
Total number of enemies killed based on, which ones you did and which ones the Freedom Fighters did for you.
Nice.
Although you see that I am a lot more accurate than my Freedom Fighters, even though they are more deadly.
Yeah.
And they spend...
Volume.
Ooh, and 32 megabytes of... I just love the idea that we're talking about... RAM in megabytes again. Yeah, that was a thing that seemed to escalate very quickly. Even better. I remember it being a great deal once. This is going to make me sound like an old man. Of a computer store in my town was selling 8 megs of RAM for $80, and this was
only $10. Wait,
this was considered at the time a flaming deal. And,
yeah,
and now I
Soviet reinforcements.
Oh, it's not. Let's go to the harbor.
Seize the warehouse.
Clear out these warehouse buildings.
This is where the Soviets store their small arms.
Ooh, is there a discussion about the Amiga?
Yes, the talk in the chat has turned to the Amiga, which was a wonderful gaming machine.
Did you ever have an Amiga?
I did not. I had a friend who had an Amiga.
I am in the similar position of having a friend who had an Amiga.
I remember going to his place to play lots of awesome Psygnosis games.
Yes,
Blood Money, and I remember they all had really great box art. Anyway,
yeah, play some Lemmings and
sure.
What was it? Shadow of the Beast.
Was that on Amiga? Anyway, Shadow of the Beast. Apparently,
it certainly
yes.
was on an Amiga. Where I'm hazy on is if it was a Psygnosis game, which I think it was.
Always,
well, that's a lot of Russians.
People want to know who is the mysterious figure behind the GameSpot account. I will not reveal their identity, but if they wish to reveal their own identity, they may do so.
I will say that I won't reveal the identity because, it's a bit... What's the best thing? I guess you could say it's a bit like Top Gear's The Stig, in that it changes.
The game this is true.
The GameSpot account
yes.
is not a single person. It is...
There's a little GameSpot in all of us,
Tyler. It's a collection of beliefs.
Yes. it's kind of... It's like...
When you wear the GameSpot mantle.
Yeah. GameSpot... What's the belief system we were talking about earlier in Dead Space?
Oh, Unitology.
GameSpot is a lot like Unitology in that way. it's a system of beliefs.
GameSpot has never coerced me into murdering my family, however. That's the key difference.
Yet.
There's still time.
Yes, so GameSpot, the man behind the GameSpot account currently is none other than Dan Mihoric.
Which, who in case you're ever wondering, that is also how you pronounce Dan Mihoric.
I'm going to click on this link to some Psygnosis. Oh, no, I can't get to that.
You cannot, yeah.
Oh, well.
It is forbidden.
It is forbidden.
Unfortunately, in the harbor, I left myself close to a safe spot here that has no freedom fighters, but plenty of Russians, so I'm...
So you're on your own.
I'm kind of gutting my way through here.
All right.
That's okay, because I'm about to... Look at these wacky Russians.
Ooh, you got the drop on these guys.
These silly Russians.
yuck. Do you ever have to like so this is game this game is obviously set in New York. Do you visit any like do you ever have to hoist the American flag over the Statue of Liberty or
I'm trying to remember now. Like one of the final chapters in the game is like this one of the biggest areas you see yet.
Okay.
And it's all set on Ellis Island.
Oh, sure.
And this you know, the set piece is like the entire Atlantic Ocean around the around Ellis Island has frozen over.
Ooh.
And I think there's like a Russian submarine, you know, control tower that's like breached through the ice. So it has all of the, you know, at least that one right there has all that the dramatic tropes you could possibly hope for.
Nice.
I believe. Also, there's sort of like a Times Square kind of area.
Yeah, I think I saw that. I glimpsed that in one of the attract mode movies that played before we started the stream.
Right. I keep running out of bullets. I'm just going to club him in his face here. But, you know, a lot of the... But they save that stuff early on.
Okay.
Yeah, so right now we're just kind of working through the generic...
Sure. Like,
hotel and firehouse and
yeah
things like that. But we're about to recruit some people to our noble cause of murdering Russians.
Doesn't get much more noble than that.
Well, okay, let's put this in context. Murdering communists.
Yeah.
Let's see. Check my map here. Okay, I'm mostly heading in the right direction. Wonder if I should go back to the rebel base and do a quick save here. So that
couldn't hurt.
Kong Plus, who is saying it's amazing to think how recently in memory this game came out, but it was 10 years ago. Yeah, right there with you.
Yeah.
It did not occur even playing this game this weekend. It did not occur to me that this game is 10 years old.
The time she flies.
And it was supposed to be that the squad command mechanics in this game was supposed to be carried through into the Kane and Lynch games. Although I never stuck with those games long enough to actually see those mechanics in play in it. Did you ever play any of those games?
Heck no.
Okay. we'll have to take it as empirical knowledge that that was a thing.
Hit their position. Go.
Take them down.
That car is already burned out. I cannot... shoot it to make it explode.
Let's see. From the Wikipedia page for this game, on April 6, 2004, Eidos UK revealed plans for a sequel, that it would be distributed in the first half of financial year 2006.
A sequel to this game?
Yes. Yeah. However, IO Interactive announced development of a new IP, Kane and Lynch, Dead Man, casting the future of a Freedom Fighter sequel in doubt. Yeah.
Which is fine. I mean, you know, this... Much as this game would have been great to see have a sequel.
Sure.
It's not like... I mean, thankfully, the story wrapped up nicely in such a way that it didn't purposefully leave anything open for a sequel. So it came out as pretty satisfying overall.
Yeah.
Of ammunition again.
Report any activity.
Team eliminate.
Hey, get these guys.
Oh, woo, that was close.
Oh, don't run in front of the guy with the machine gun. Life advice.
Come here so that I might hit you with my rifle.
Relax. Got you.
Relax.
It'll be all right. You may have been dead in the street before, but you're okay now. Oh, back in an era when games were more innocent and more ridiculous. People don't often remember this game as a brawler. Probably because it wasn't very good at being a brawler. I don't think there's any good stuff up here to know.
Nothing.
Not a dang bit of nothing.
Just to keep you appraised, Tyler, talk in the chat has now turned to appreciations of the rich, rich sound of Brad Shoemaker's voice.
It is it's rich, velvety sound.
It's good old slow-talking Brad Shoemaker.
All right. Maybe we'll try a different route through the harbor here. Not go straight up the middle, as we had done previously. Yeah, Brad Shoemaker, great voice. and you often hear the folks from Giant Bomb, from our streaming room here, because on the other side of this thin wall behind us is where they do all of their shooting.
Yes.
So,
often I'll be doing a live stream here, and I'll hear them saying just hilarious stuff, and it makes it that much harder for me to keep it together and press on with whatever it is I'm doing.
But press on we must.
Yeah. You gotta just tell them.
Production-wise, it's been discussed that we should do something about that,
I mean, look, I'm just gonna tell them straight up to stop being so funny. I mean, I think that's really what it comes down to. But,
if we did something about those, soundproof those walls, then we wouldn't have discussions in the chat about Brad Shoemaker's velvety voice.
True.
I hope Brad doesn't mind me describing his voice as velvety. That brings me no closer to my objective. Oh, you're one of my guys.
Regroup! Move! Move! Move!
All right, if this game has one flaw, it's the kind of sometimes busted-sounding dialogue.
Here.
But we can forgive that.
Sure.
It's already getting better.
What? Did he say, it's already getting better?
That's what he said. Maybe this isn't such a bad way to go. Hey, stop killing my dudes.
This'll fix you up.
Whoa.
Oh no.
Oh. Oh. Ah. Boo.
All right. Let's try a different area. Maybe the good old harbor is not for us just yet. Let's try and take... Oh, we got that. The firehouse next? No, we did the firehouse. No, we did the hotel. Fire station it is.
Okay.
Fire station. Soviet reinforcements in this section are coordinated from here. Then...
Righty-ho! There's a door right behind them, and sometimes you just want to open it. This is what Dan Mahorik is saying. Just open it up while Giant Bomb is streaming, and we're streaming, and just have, like, a big old CBS Interactive live streaming block party.
Come with me. Follow
Let's
me.
Go. Let's do it.
All right. I've got my dudes, and I think this is just getting around the corner where that... Oh, to where that impassable chain link fence is.
That's why the Russians must be overthrown. The tyranny of impassable chain link fences.
And another one.
I guess you can shoot through it.
Get back here.
You heard me.
Stop. You, come on, punks.
Nope, can't go that way.
Okay, the kid. The kid's just staring
What's
at a wall.
On, kid?
he's just
trying to think of like what.
Don't interrupt his wall staring. He's deep in the zone.
Hit the seed. Defend squad.
Kong Plus says, must have been funny to see them filming their Game of the Year stuff. Indeed it was. It was, you know, I'd just be working on a review or whatever at my desk, and I'd hear, I'd hear them just shout just whatever nonsense they were shouting for their various Game of the Year stuff.
Most of my experience with them is, like, seeing them, yeah, because that was kind of my desk at the time was situated in this, like, choke point between where they... all sit in to get their work done, and where most of the GameSpot video team is. And I would just see, like, Ryan Davis walk by my desk without any acknowledgement of the absolutely ridiculous outfit he's
right,
wearing.
Exactly.
And just walk on by. And just
business as usual.
Yeah. You know. Okay, game. So now that I've done that bridge, what for?
So the fire station. Oh, right. We don't know how to get across.
Oh, I think
here.
I blew up the wrong bridge.
The game wouldn't. The game wouldn't let you do that.
The game has let me blow up the wrong bridge.
Surely the game would not let you do something that would get you into a position from which you can't.
No, but okay. I think that's.
Oh, there you go. Walk it off. Walk it off.
Doing it. But the bridge I need to blow up is further down.
Sorry, Mario. The bridge you need to blow up is...
It's further down the rail station. Okay, so... That's fine. We'll just... we'll first make sure we're not going to get hit by a train. Because that would be bad.
Yeah.
And then we'll just mosey on down and blow up this bridge. We're just going to blow up all the bridges in this town until there aren't any bridges left. Just kind of take the Terminator Sarah Connor approach to things.
Right.
Brooklyn Bridge.
Yes.
Okay. Part of it is over.
Totally could have been hit by a train.
All right. Let's blow up a train. Bridge. Thing.
A train bridge thing.
If we get a train in there too, then great.
So much the better.
Hey!
Who is that over there?
Oh, wait. You're a friendly freedom fighter.
Yeah.
Okay. I believe we're what would be referred to as in business.
Kong Plus says, this game would have received a 10 out of 10 if Beastie Boys did the soundtrack. True, but you can say that about any game.
Yeah, I can't think of any game that would be harmed by having a Beastie Boys soundtrack. Going the right way. You can tell that because there are Freedom Fighters here. Hello, Freedom Fighters. Are you fighting freedom? All right.
So wait, did you free the fire station? Like, is that done or
what? The fire station has been liberated.
Yes, excellent.
And
okay.
But I still had this secondary objective of, and actually, let me take a quick look at the map here. Okay, so I haven't done the fire station.
Okay.
So you have the secondary objective that you see with that now green exploded area.
Sure.
Saying I needed to take out this bridge. I thought I'd taken out the bridge. I'd taken out the wrong bridge. I still need to do the fire station. I have claimed the hotel. And again, like, each one of these secondary objectives kind of makes your other primary objectives either completable or at least, more easily achievable.
Right.
So, you know, every little bit of progress that you make certainly helps. Not every little bit, but every significant milestone you make. Like, if you just go through and kill a bunch of Russians and then die, that does not further your progress.
Recon, let's go! Defend this area! Go, go, go!
Unfortunately, one thing that I don't recall a lot of from this game being reviewed in this office during a time when Greg Kasavin was also in this office, but no real knowledge of what the common Russian phrases are, although I'm sure that...
Well, the GameSpot review, I for all I know, Jeff may have consulted with Greg on this, but it did say something about the Russians speaking in their native tongue. Let me see if I can find it here.
Sweep that air. Regroup, all of you!
I don't know. The Russian soldiers sound appropriately menacing and communicate with each other in their native language.
There's that fire station I needed to lay claim to.
Yeah, look
that machine
gunner,
look
at that filthy...
If that machine gunner comes back, I'm going to take him down with well-placed groin shots. It's the weakness of any machine gunner. Kill that guy because I'm out of bullets.
Jack, come on.
Yeah, get all of them again because I still only have 14 bullets.
Four. Do it. Hit it.
Okay. I like to think we're close to the liberation of this fire station.
did see the flag, the red flag, flying over the station. Can't be too far off.
Destroy that obstacle! Get moving!
Yeah, the game doesn't teach you overtly about them in, you know, a lot of other games might do, but, you know, flank and maneuvering kind of tactics do work out pretty well in this game, where you can kind of, you know, tell your guys to attack from one side and then you sweep around together to, you know, kind of get them on their blind side. You know, kind of that aggro mechanic that, what was it, Army of Two, rested so heavily on.
Sidburn19 says, is this the Ghostbusters fire station? Since this game takes place in New York, I'm just going to go ahead and say yes. Yes, it is.
I'm going to have to say maybe not, just because I didn't see any evidence of a fireman's pole.
Oh, Tyler, why must you ruin my dream?
I know, but it's just, it's so important to the...
Yeah, you're right.
All right. Let's raise our proud American flag over the fire station. Although, Also, I didn't see... Wait, was there a secretary's desk there? Was there anywhere for Janine to sit? All right.
It's now or never, Chris, with the fire station under our control. Seize the warehouse buildings.
Let's get these warehouse buildings.
Yes.
Our campaign has been successful thus far, even though this...
Can't possibly fight for freedom without a warehouse under your belt.
Nope. Especially if it's, you know, a warehouse full of Russian... I don't know, what would the Russians be stockpiling?
Caviar.
Yes. and someone's asking, please liberate Rick Moranis, please. I think that these are... Like the Rick Moranis twin Freedom Fighter. So we'll get two Rick Moranises for the price of one. And they will help me in our fight for freedom.
Move in! Move! Move! Move!
Maybe this is the machine gun I should have been using the whole time to take down this camp. Only trouble here is, at this distance, it's hard to tell which are their guys and which are mine. Now I'm getting this dramatic flashing in both monitors there that was producing a sort of hypnotic effect.
Pull out! Let's go!
Oh, everybody's dead. That's really unfortunate. And they're shooting at me.
They're shooting your feet.
All right. I'm trying to remember what happens if when I have a bunch of injured freedom fighters and I just go and recruit new ones. If I'm beholden to those guys being in my squad, whether they, you know, if I could just abandon them on the battlefield, that would be some real...
Fade away.
Ooh, there's a warehouse you can go in here.
Ricky Guitarist says, do you think we'll ever see a proper sequel to Freedom Fighters or just more Kane and Lynch games? I don't know if we'll ever see...
I would say you could probably bet against ever seeing a proper Freedom Fighters game again.
Yeah.
I don't think it's without an old timer like I don't think it's beyond expectation that we could see a game like this.
Sure. Oh, definitely.
You know, some kind of squad-based, you know, or tactical shooter kind of thing. Although we have seen plenty of games like, you know, that have, you know, pretty much the core elements of this sort of thing in it. I mean, even like Mass Effect had, you know, some of the same squad ordering mechanics that this game did. But it's one of those where I think that it's in license hell with, like, EA has the license to this game, but I think, you know, maybe IO Interactive can be the only ones to develop it, and that's not going to be the case because I believe the relationship there is that Eidos is now owned 100% by Square Enix. Yeah, so it's pretty unlikely that it would take a very strange set of circumstances for there to ever be a Freedom Fighters game again. Pick these guys off with my sniping rifle. That is now bullets. Well, that's enough of that fun.
Fun while it lasted.
Oh, that's just that guy who's just... Thank you for your gun, sir.
Some good I'm getting beaten up sound effects there.
Okay, I should probably head back downstairs and maybe revive my guys. Should go help them out if the massive tide of Russians is not too untenable at this point. Let's see. Well, I've got my machine gun. Blow up this car before it does me more harm than good. Trouble is, I don't even know where any of my guys are. Oh, there's one. There's two of them.
Oh, yeah. There's all three. And you can now recruit a fourth.
Yes.
You're gonna be fine.
It's cool, bro. Alright.
Hit them!
Do it!
In case you
all those medic kits, what were you saying?
I was just gonna say, you know, and we've just passed the sort of 1 hour mark here. Just gonna let people know in case they've joined us recently that we are streaming the 2003 release Freedom Fighters, playing on an Xbox 360. You know, backwards compatible with the Xbox version. This is GameSpot. You're watching us probably on twitch.tv/GameSpot or maybe on GameSpot.com.
All right.
Fall back, team!
Now we're into the warehouse building compound, which is good because it has lots of cover. I like lots of cover. There's our jolly Russian flag.
Yeah.
And here, this must be the warehouse of the embargo shipping company.
They might have wanted to think that name over, but
yeah, I'm in.
And fortunately, we find ourselves a little sewer cover here, so we can do a quick save. That way, if there's any unplanned deaths, we can recover from that pretty easily. But now we can begin our final push into the warehouse of the Embargo Shipping Company.
Yeah.
And we will show the Reds. As soon as I remember to double check my map. Hello, warehouse.
Let's take them out.
Go, go, go!
Tommy Joe 2 asks, is there friendly fire in this game?
I don't believe so. Which is good, because, you know, there's so much of this game that you're just kind of firing into a massive melee of people. And, you know, you saw, when I was, like, machine gunning some of those greater distances.
Yeah.
It is incredibly difficult to tell.
Sure.
One soldier, particularly when you have the guys in your squad there, like the revived or, you know, healed up Russian soldiers, that you really can't tell the difference between the two.
Yeah.
So I think that, you know, just to smooth out, you know, issues that could arise with the gameplay, they just decided, you know, we're not going to bother with the realistic nature of friendly fire.
Nice to see that ladies can be freedom fighters too.
Freedom sees no gender.
Yes.
We haven't been throwing many grenades. I also love that the cute little hop that our hero, Chris Stone, makes when
he just loves throwing grenades.
Well, I just threw a grenade at my own guy. Sorry, guy. And of course, the game also has the Freedom Fighter's favorite weapon ever, the Molotov cocktail.
Yes.
Which is also part of the logo for the game, so of course it made perfect sense for them to include it as a usable weapon. Oh, there are people attacking us from way up there.
Regroup, squad.
I still need to figure out how to get up there. At least I now got my a decently sized freedom fighting posse around me. I have a feeling that I need to go. Oh, I'm quite sure I need to go up there, because now I see the flag. I think I just shot that guy in the genital area.
Whatever works.
The ironic thing is that he has a much higher range rifle than I do, but that's fine. He can do anything with an AK-47. If there's anything that video games have taught me, it's that.
Yes.
Ah, and Now we will do this for freedom. Have we heard? Can you butter toast with an AK-47? I believe you can. I think that I mean, you know, you might get a little bit of gun oil in with your butter, but you know. But actually, after you fired a couple of rounds through it, then you know, it will also help melt your butter. All right, so that was the end of one of the chapters of Freedom Fighters.
The Soviet newscasts.
I believe she just took a shot of vodka before starting this news broadcast.
Good evening. This is Tatiana Kempinski at SAFN Studios in New York.
Autumn so they all kind of kick off with this, you know,
chill in the air, but the occupied, of New York,
you know,
are coping. Thanks to
country
many
news
Soviet
broadcast.
Engineers working overtime to repair the many power stations that were damaged during the recent rash of rebel attacks. Freedom Phantom,
which, you know, mostly they just serve as the filthy Russian propaganda.
Right.
But one of the things that this game I always thought did pretty well at the time was also kind of evolve the way your character looks from chapter to chapter. I mean, you know,
Freedom Phantom character and his rabid followers are really achieving is
punishing. You know, you start out and you're just kind of like this fresh-faced plumber, and then, you know, as, by the second chapter he's got a, you know, flak jacket. You know, he's got, you know, kind of adopted more of the guerrilla fighter look, and by the end he's just, you know, his hair's grown out and shaggy, and he's just got this, you know, steely look across his face. He's wearing the American flag as like a bandana over his face.
And if this doesn't happen soon, severe measures will be taken against any collaborators and all others helping them. What are your comments on that?
We hope to resolve this in civilized way without further collateral damage. We are here to restore stability, not disrupt it. No further questions, please. Spasibo.
We will be back.
He said spasibo. That means
stay
thank you.
Us.
Wait, or is that they say thank you or me? Thank you or please? That goes. That was it for my Russian knowledge.
Yeah. Lord Sloth in the chat says, was hoping for Freedom Force, but a new game that I haven't seen before could be quite interesting. Freedom Force, obviously a completely different game, but a really good superhero-themed sort of turn-based strategy game. You know, I guess you could say sort of in the XCOM-ish vein.
And that was a game that was, like, each character had their own individual abilities.
Yeah, exactly. Which was super fun. They had great, personalities and varied abilities. They really felt like a superhero squad of the 1940s.
Right. I don't know much about that. That game wasn't from Irrational, was it?
I couldn't say.
It's connected, though. We'd be nowhere without.
So now, as you can see that characters changed a little bit.
Yeah.
I think it's in the wintertime now, so we start seeing some snow, and he's got like a heavy parka on.
Good work handling
this. Oh, and we have another warehouse district or a power plant. Or a movie theater. Oh, and we're in downtown Manhattan now, so I think we're start seeing a little, maybe not overt references to New York City landmarks, but, you know, seeing a couple more similar things to it. So we've got a helipad and a movie theater to lay claim to.
Bring down the bridges.
We can free some prisoners. Oh, and blow lots of bridges to blow up.
Awesome.
And,
take out the power station on the Manhattan
Transformer towers and power plants. But let's try. What do you think? Should we try with the movie theater?
I like the sound of the movie theater. Yeah.
Let's go see what's going on with the theater.
Soviets are using it to temporarily.
Doesn't see where we're starting out here, so.
Sending them to Alaskan labor camp.
Let's just go for it. A couple people talking about Red Dawn, which this game is kind of a representation of. There is a new Red Dawn. Did the remake of Red Dawn already come out?
Oh, yeah. It's come and gone.
Okay. That's probably for the better.
Yeah.
Although, if I'm honest, I never saw the original Red Dawn. I'm ashamed to admit.
Let's move.
Let's do it.
I was going to shout Wolverines, but now that...
I do understand the Wolverines reference.
Okay, all right.
I can't lay claim to that.
Okay.
But, I mean, if you're hungry for other media in this vein, I mean, there's... I don't know much about the show, but there's a show... I kind of did it a little bit on purpose that there's a show launching on the FX network called The Americans, which if I understand what I've seen of that show thus far, it's about Russian spies embedded in America during the Cold War. So if you want to relive your Cold War Russia invasion fantasy even further, check that show out.
Regroup.
Hey guys, where are you going? Don't attack those guys without cover. Plus, I can get you some help.
Of course, go, let's go.
Look at this ragtag bunch of freedom fighters. You can, hey, ladies.
Two of this model, you know. Yeah.
What are you ladies doing tonight? Would you like to fight for some freedom? I will only accept the answer of yes.
Get back here!
Where to?
Pull out,
all of you!
There is a sniping man doing a sniping.
Regroup! Get moving!
As those Think sniping of. Mans are wont to do.
There's my gaggle of people. I'm hoping that this will...
Oh.
Hello, everyone.
Well, God, this... this well, party we could take two of
this party is awkward.
Yeah.
We go further up. I'm hoping this will give me a good vantage point onto that helipad I'm supposed to liberate. Although I don't know if I have the proper helipad.
Oh. Well,
glad that guy's done with.
Scout that area. Everybody.
Okay, you got
Abort.
It.
Move.
On my way.
Ah.
That was a poor place to take some cover there, dude.
Oh, so poor. Oh!
All right.
Get back here.
You heard me.
That's one of my favorite ticks in this game is that pretty much every command you issue, it's like almost like he's arguing with himself. It's like there's a command and like a counter argument to it.
Just immediately. Oh, yeah.
All right. Now the troublesome thing here is I don't know if I have the appropriate liberation tools, otherwise known as C4.
Oh, well, you have some C4. Oh,
yes, I still have some C4. Great. All right. Let's not get blowed up.
Lord Sloth says, tell me we get to fight a Robo-Putin.
Putin. This was actually before the reign of good old Vladimir.
Yes.
So unfortunately, that will not be the case. What was the name of the robot in Fallout 3? I remember he had... It was like a reprogrammed communist robot.
Right.
Hey, everybody. We're here to fight for freedom and blow up helicopters. Will you join our worthy cause?
You had me at blow up helicopters.
And I can't believe I'm forgetting the name of the giant robot from who's like Freedom Tron 1000. But strong anti-communist sentiment in that guy, although the communists he was concerned with in that case, I believe, were the Chinese. The guy just doesn't learn.
I know.
Although I think this is the... This might be the movie theater I need to be concerned
with.
Sure,
looks like a movie theater.
In which case, if I could just get this all done right now. It doesn't look quite that easy, though.
Here.
You need help. So I will administrate that help.
Destroy that obstacle! Come on!
No!
What happened with that car? Alright, I'm going to go back to the Rebel base and see what kind of other activities we can get up to. Maybe we're not ready for the you know, maybe we need to complete other objectives before we can liberate the movie theater.
Get your charisma up some, maybe.
Yeah, well, it's not doing too bad. I mean, we've got a strong squad so far.
Oh, sure.
Let's see. Warehouse district sounds like a great... Oh, that's why this is where we need to blow up a lot of stuff. But hopefully we'll be able to stock up on supplies as well.
I don't know. Probably worked on Wall Street.
Do we have any...
Oh, there you are. Good work handling that Soviet stronghold. Variants
hired. I'm not sure if I have any C4 I can stock up on there, but we'll just go with this for now. Liberate some prisoners. That'll get our charisma up nice and high. Maybe we can get our squad of 6 people.
Wow.
Get over here! Come with me!
You're it's your thing. Lead on. Lead on!
Yeah. We definitely don't want you, fifth guy.
I mean, you seem like you mean well, but I don't know. This is the way to... Well, here's a bridge to blow up. Oh, you're just a...
A civilian?
A passerby.
Oh,
don't... Yeah, let's not get hit by the car again. All right, that was a polite little street skirmish there. And I don't want to interrupt your walk home, lady, but this bridge has got to go. But it's going to go in the name of freedom.
Get back here! Get moving!
Right behind you!
Myself and another little dollop of charisma.
Would you like to add charisma to your burrito for just $1.79?
Hello, everybody.
Let's take them out.
We notice you're threatening our freedom.
I got you now.
Oh, that's a helicopter.
Regroup! Move! Move! Move!
Lead on!
I wonder if that's an indication that we should find a helipad.
Can you, blow up that enemy helicopter?
Not with any of the tools I have at my disposal now.
Okay, not with just plain old bullets.
Okay.
Oh, look out. Call Me Joe 2 asks, how long is Freedom Fighters? Based on the reviews that I've glanced at, it sounds like it's around the 12-hour mark?
You know, I would imagine if you have the capability of just hammering straight through it.
Yeah.
You know, I could see it lasting around that long. You know, the reality of it is that, you know, it'll probably last you longer unless you're... you know, as you kind of poke and prod your way through the game.
Right.
I mean, when I play the game, you know, including, you know, foibles and missteps,
yeah.
I would clock it in, you know, much more likely at around, you know, 20 hours, as I believe what I ended up getting out of it.
Call Me Joe 2 also asks, does your character level, only in the sense, right, that his charisma goes up, and each time, which is the sort of orange bar underneath the green health bar in the upper left, and each time that fills up, you can then recruit another member to your squad. So right now you can have 4 active Freedom Fighters. Once you've filled up that charisma bar once again, you'll then be able to have 5 active Freedom Fighters.
Correct. Yeah, so that's the most meaningful character progression that you get out of this game, is being able to lead a bigger crew into battle.
Yeah.
I think I should focus on trying to liberate that prison squad. Or the prison camp, which I'm going the wrong way towards.
Free Soul VW says this game looks old. It is. It came out in 2003.
Yeah.
So it is. You know.
Looks aren't
about
deceiving.
10 years old at this point.
This game is old.
Yes. Enjoy Mangoes, who's casting right now. Playing, we have GameSpot's own Tyler Weingarner, and I am Carolyn Pettit, also GameSpot's own.
To find my way to that prison camp. So, while not getting killed by a helicopter. Ah! Ah! Oh no.
Oh, look no, out! No, look no, out! No, no, oh, no, no, God. No.
Oh.
Yes.
If only we'd realized at the time our cars are the most deadly addition to the Russian arsenal.
For real, yes.
Abort!
This is quite cool. I like that that image of the sort of battleship silhouetted in the rain there.
Yeah.
It's got a sense of drama. Call Me Joe 2 says, anyone played Sleeping Dogs? Which, of course, I did. I wrote the review for GameSpot.com. I enjoyed that game very much.
Likewise, I've been enjoying that game, and it's, kind of the second swing of popularity of it.
Yeah.
I guess its second swing kind of was its first swing.
As it was in development as true crime Hong Kong for so long.
Well, mostly just talking about how, like, that game, I feel like it kind of came out to a pretty quiet reception.
Yeah.
And then, like, as more people start playing about, you know, playing it,
it's just the word of mouth on it was really good. I think a lot of people before it came out just looked at it and was like, you know, it's probably just going to be like a B-tier GTA clone. But then the game came out and people were like, dude, this is an awesome B-tier GTA clone.
Yeah.
You know, like, this game is just super fun.
Yeah, that game was a ton of fun. Oh, I need to... This is an electrified fence around this prison camp. I cannot liberate these prisoners. That must be why I need to take down that... The power generator I saw in that one other objective. Oh, God.
Oh, man.
Okay. This is where... Although I don't know if I want to open up this sewer tunnel, because this is just going to be around a bunch of... Are there any men who will fight for our freedom down here? No, there's just...
Relax. I got you.
Well, you'll help me out.
Yeah, he'll rejoin the fight for freedom.
I don't know. He's looking a little worse for wear, though. I mean, I don't want to look a gift horse in the mouth or nothing, but... Gift freedom fighter in the mouth as it is.
Go, go, go. Get up. Pull out. You heard me.
But yeah, I think one of my favorite things about Sleeping Dogs is just all the dumb stuff you can do, particularly in that game with, like, motorcycles and other vehicles.
That, yeah. Yeah, the sort of action hijackings and all that are...
Well, that stuff is great, too, but uh-huh. Also just, like, because that game has very few rules on where you can drive vehicles...
Yeah.
Yeah, you can kind of just... Like, I oftentimes will, just park my motorcycle in my apartment. Or I remember, you know, one sequence early on involved me meeting a crime boss at an outdoor market, and I just parked my motorcycle on the table while we were having a conversation with him.
Yeah, the game really lets you live the dream.
Yes. Although... Was, you know, I picked up the game on Steam, and so I got a bunch of, like, Valve-related shirts along with it.
Oh, yeah.
And I wanted to... It didn't let me fully live my dream of having my character dressed up as, like, the PAX attendee. With, like, the Team Fortress 2 sandwich shirt, and I could get the fedora and the aviator sunglasses. But there's no Utilikilt in that game.
Ah.
So...
That's where they went wrong.
That's where that idea fell short.
Yeah.
Don't shoot me with your machine gun.
Eliminate.
I'm liberating America. Yeah, but that game is a ton of fun. Admittedly, I've kind of fallen off the wagon a little bit with it. I haven't...
All of you.
You know,
yeah.
new games like, you know, there's a lot in that game. And with new stuff like DMC coming out, I haven't been able to give it all the attention it deserves.
Sure.
But it's definitely a game I want to continue playing when I get more time for it.
Hey, try this.
Yeah, I think one of the refinements that definitely would have
helped
with this game is just making the med pack, you know, the health action a little bit more accessible.
Yeah, instead of having to go in just into your inventory,
go into
just like a one button.
Yeah, like, I mean, because it's not even just that you have to go into your inventory to use it, but it's not even, like, even if one of the inventory things were like one of the cardinal directions would have helped. Instead, it's like this slightly, you know...
Yeah,
it's not directly to the right. It's like to the right and down a little bit. These are things that games make games unnecessarily hard.
Search over there. Go, go, go!
lots of twins in the Freedom Fighters.
It took a lot of memory to render a lot of unique characters.
Yes, it did.
That was not what things we can... That was not easily accomplishable in 2003. It was also a time before the melee attack was the most deadly weapon in the war combatant's arsenal. So you needed to elbow dudes several times before they would keel over dead.
Regroup!
Move! Move! Move!
Alright. Now is a good time to figure out if there are any lootable medic kits. Oh, I see two.
Just add water for instant medic.
Because I have people that need healing help, and I probably could also use.
So you've got four already, four guys, and then there's that wounded guy there.
I think that was a case of where I ended up replacing a wounded guy with somebody who was fresh.
Right.
Sorry,
wounded guy.
The medevac team will be along shortly. And I think this is where I would have been greatly benefited by checking my map, because I think I've actually been heading in the wrong direction for the old power station. Although I will also need some... Okay, so now I'm headed in the right direction. I'm also going to need some C4 sooner or later, but I'll just assume that that bridge will get crossed at an appropriate time. Meanwhile, mug this guy for more medic kits.
Pull out! Fall back!
You heard me!
Do we have anything from the old chat?
Right now people are chatting about their favorite Dreamcast games.
Oh man, favorite. I think.
Attack squad!
I think my favorite Dreamcast game was probably Jet Set Radio.
Certainly.
I mean, to be fair here, because that game. My favorite game still of all time is Ikaruga.
Ah, okay.
And
which came out on the
came out as a Japanese only import on the Dreamcast, and it was not a game I knew about in my period of owning a Dreamcast. Through that circuitous logic, I can determine that Ikaruga is my favorite Dreamcast game. But I can't really claim that one because that's not really. I didn't know about that game at the time.
Ain't no way you're gonna blow that power plant. Look, taking out the power lines in the back will do the trick.
Thanks, kid. taking out the power lines in the back sounds like the order of the day. We'll go through this construction yard. If we can. Yes, we can. Take that, buddy. Well, if I want that,
Move in! Come on!
Attack! I'll place C4.
We can make this real easy.
Should blow up real good.
Transformer tower destroyed.
Yeah. Look out.
Don't follow me, don't follow me, don't follow me.
Don't follow me, bro.
Regroup.
Do it.
I've kind of done the scumbag thing of, you know, let my dudes all go and die while I blew stuff up behind them.
Take them down, all of you!
But it's cool. We're victorious. Get up, buddy. Actually, I guess I don't really need to heal them. That would just be a waste of my medic kits.
Sure.
the cold calculus
that is,
of war.
Yeah. Wow, no kidding.
Take this.
You've done your job.
Yeah.
Good work. Let's see. Is that a... That was it. No, you're just an AI-busted Russian. Hello, more Russians.
Say duh. You've just got me to say duh by having the username of say duh.
Duh.
Says of you, he Rambos this game so hard. What he means is, he says, when I played this, I actually used Iron Sight and Cover Fire more. So I guess you are taking the more direct, perhaps somewhat reckless approach than that employed by, say, duh.
I'm doing that largely because, well, it looks better on the, when I played this game originally, and is there a... There is a sewer tunnel entrance somewhere nearby here. Yes, very, very much so when I originally played this game. I played in the way that say, duh, is prescribing. But yeah, just for the sake of internet entertainment, that is not how it is. That's not how it's going down today. Okay, I'm bad at map reading. This sewer entrance still eludes me. That's okay. It gives me a more opportunity to do more Ramboing.
And, you know, just killing Russians, which is never time wasted.
It is the name of the game. Yes. Well, actually, no, the name of the game is Freedom Fighters, but...
It amounts to basically the same thing. How does one fight for freedom? One kills Russians.
Yes.
Basically.
Squad. Here. Okay. Back down into the sewers. Now we can liberate that prison camp.
Tyler, you're a Fallout fan, right? You were just talking about Fallout 3 anyway.
Correct.
Call Me Joe 2. Tosses out the question, anyone expecting Fallout 4 for the lineup for release titles on the new consoles?
There's been no hard announcement of it yet. There's been, the hints like the actor for the character Three Dog?
That's right, Three Dog,
Mentioned that he was working on that game.
Children?
Bethesda Softworks is on a tear right now as far as, game development.
Yeah, no kidding.
Skyrim will be one of the most fondly remembered games of this generation.
For sure.
They would be... So, I think it's as close as, without having a hard announcement in your hands or seen on the internet, it's about as close as you can get.
Yeah.
I'd say it's
whether it'll be announced as a kind of, big PS4, launch title or anything like that. I don't know. But it's certainly, it's coming at some point.
Okay, well, this is interesting because I would have thought that taking out that power station would have allowed me to gain access to that prison camp, but apparently that is not the case. And I am without medical supplies.
Oh, dear.
This will not be my most successful mission yet. Also, I think we're getting a weird audio bug where there is no audio.
Hmm. Oh, you're right.
And I'm dead. Maybe let's try one of the other territories now that... See what that, liberating that, power station, or at least taking up that power, that tower of power, got us. So it's the transformer tower and the power station itself. Maybe that was what the kid was advising me on, was the how to take down the power station. What else we got? We still got the movie theater district.
Yep.
We could go back there and see what's up with our good friend at the helipad. That's right, we nearly found our way into the movie theater.
Huh, still no audio for...
Still have our weird audio bug.
Yeah.
That's fine. Then we'll just hear a lot less of, Team Squad, get back here!
You heard me!
And we just hear all the more music from Jesper Kidd.
Jesper Kidd, yes.
Who has such a notable video... He's kind of the... I don't know. What... Well, do you know film composers that well? Would you call him the Hans Zimmer of video games, if you would make such a comparison?
Sure.
In terms of, like, just being prolific and...
Yes.
And pretty much across the board good.
Yeah, exactly. Reliable, kind of, versatile, I'd say.
Yeah. He did the soundtrack for a lot of the Assassin's Creed games and...
Right.
That's probably what he's most famous for. He kind of got his start with doing the... what else did he do? He did the... but he's, you know, kind of got his start doing the Hitman soundtracks. Most recently turned in the fantastic soundtrack for Darksiders 2.
Oh, right.
I'm going to open this sewer.
Don't worry. A GameSpot in the chat, it has us covered with sound effect generation in the text of the chat. and other users, too. SidBurn19 chiming in with pow, pow, pow.
Boom. And one fun discovery I had made while working on the most recent episode of Lost Between Levels... was that so the developers at DICE that or the developers when they're
so when you so say the most recent you're referring to the Stockholm
yes.
episode yes
so we visited DICE and spoke with Carl Magnus Trodsen, and he was talking about how the original founders of DICE came from what is referred to largely in Europe, but you know is not isolated to there as the demo scene, which are, you know, these, you know, developers working in, what used to be a really low-level programming code. Hey, I remember this room.
Yes.
But you're full of medical supplies. I'm going to have all of them. Oh, apparently I am also full of medical supplies. Low-level, you know, programming code, you know, to eke out these incredible 3D demos when 3D gaming wasn't even a thing that really happened very often. You know, it was very resource intensive, and these guys, you know, just coded these really, you know, impressive, you know, technically impressive computer, you know, basically, you know, kind of sound and light shows when I'm referring to demos.
Yeah.
The original founding team at DICE came from one of these demo groups called The Silence, and one of the demos that I found on them had music composed by Jesper Kidd.
Oh, cool.
So that was a neat find. I'm remembering I had blown up this helipad before, but
yeah.
I think because I died, that progress was not saved. So, lessons learned. Don't die. Don't get dead.
Oh,
Everybody's taking studious notes on how to place C4. This is how the placing C4 job gets done, kids.
Hold the A button.
Yeah.
Whoa!
And I get a nice little kick of charisma there.
Oh yeah, now you get.
So now I can have a fit.
Five guys!
Now I can have five times the freedom fought. And we get some more sweet music. But, let's see if we can... Power Up is fine music, but it's not this great Russian aria. And we have just been given the 10-minute warning, but that will not stop the fight for freedom. Well, actually, it will.
It will, actually, but, in 10 minutes.
But not until 10 minutes yes. have passed. So, rest assured. Oh, and...
yeah!
Dan now...
Mahorik on the wheels of steel!
Just making sure that we get fewer Russian arias and more powered up. And I've got five guys now, so I can just kind of... I can just tell people what to do now, which is good, because I have no guns. I can get a shotgun.
Call Me Joe 2 says, Dan, are you playing that end music early?
No. Dan is playing the end music early because he doesn't actually like freedom. Okay. Ooh, it is more tantalizing music from the the Industrial Shock soundtrack. That is an empty office space. Oh, you're a man who wants an elbow. Honestly, don't know which music is from Dan, which is from the game.
Eric Tay wants some Hearts on Fire.
I don't know what that is, but I hope we don't have it. Oh God. Alright. New strategy. Don't run around in front of the machine guns. This game is not doing a fine job of remembering that I've actually blown up that helipad. Which is fine. We'll just do it again.
That's how freedom rolls.
We will blow that helipad up until there is no more helipad to blow up. And we will keep fighting for freedom until all the freedom has been fought for. And I believe now we're getting Eric Tay's wish of Hearts on Fire.
Thanks, Tay.
You bring good things to life. Also, Rocky music. I like that this song actually is coming through with authentic Rocky punching sounds. Oh, is that what that was? Yeah. Okay. It sounded like punching. Is it like a punching wood chopping montage?
It's the great Rocky IV montage, I think. Well, that movie has two montages, I think. Doesn't? I don't know. I haven't actually seen it in a long time.
And my further admission of being a somewhat misguided person from the 80s, I have never seen a Rocky movie.
Not even four?
Wait, have I seen Rocky IV?
Dude!
That's the one where he fights the Russian guy, right?
Yes!
Okay, I think I have seen that one.
Okay. All right, then, because if you haven't seen that one, you're not a real American.
I know I've at least seen... Was it Superman 3?
Oh, what? 3?
With the fighting the Russian guy?
Or
was that 4?
That was 4, the Superman 4, The Quest for Peace, which I consider completely unofficial. Superman 3 is the one with Richard Pryor.
That's the only one you need.
And that has a scene where a lady gets turned into a robot, and when I was a kid...
Yes, oh, that was terrifying.
That, I mean, seriously freaked me the hell out. Oh my god, it terrified me.
Yeah, that sequence was pretty grim.
Oh.
What other communist plot, anti-communist 80s movies can we talk about? Oh, there's Ruskies.
Ruskies, yeah. We're like a bunch of kids. Like early...
Kinda, like there's like an injured Russian soldier. Like they find him in a sewer and like...
Sure.
And, you know, they're like, oh, we can help you. We can bring you food and nurse you back to health. Without any explanation as to what this Russian soldier was doing in the sewer in America. And their parents are like, no, we can't trust him. He's a Russian. And the kid's like, he's a nice guy. And I can't remember how that movie resolved.
Pretty sure love conquered all.
As it is wont to do. So we should probably start doing our wrap-up of this game.
We should start stopping.
Start doing the stopping. So we've been playing Freedom Fighters. Which is a game by IO Interactive. It was published by EA back in 2003.
That's right.
Third-person shooter with squad and strategy mechanics, and a whole lot of Red Dawn pasted over the top of it.
Definitely. A lot of hoisting of American flags and taking down Russian ones.
Yeah, as a B-list game, it's not one of those that we can say, oh, it's a flawed game, because actually that game... still holds up pretty well, aside from the fact that it's hard. But just nobody ever played it for whatever reason.
Yeah, it didn't maybe get quite the reputation or quite the reception that it deserved from the gaming public. Again, talked earlier, some very glowing reviews. Jeff Gerstmann, reviewed it here for GameSpot, gave it a 9.3. So, definitely had its fans and supporters, but maybe just a little kind of flew under the radar.
Yeah.
So it's nice to go back and... keep shine a light on it for a little while.
Yeah, so anyways, you've been watching the B-List. It is a game where we look at flawed or overlooked games.
Okay.
We'll be back next Monday with a game that I don't know what it is yet, but we'll let you know.
You'll think of something.
We'll come up with something. We've got a list. Always good. Willing to take suggestions. But if you want to see this show or more like it, subscribe to us on Twitch. Subscribe to us on YouTube. You can follow GameSpot at GameSpot on Twitter.
Yes.
And you are...
I'm Carolyn Pettit.
And I am Tyler Weingarner. And thank you very much for watching. And we'll see you soon.